and welcome. Well, this was always going to be a historic event, and certainly it became a top news from the Asian continent this week. Prime Minister Modi's brief Lahore stopover, as spontaneous and personal nature of the visit, took the world by pleasant surprise. And over in Afghanistan, Helmand is at the verge of fall as Taliban continues to engage in fierce gun battle in Sangin. The electorate in Spanish polls have thrown a fractured mandate. On the show tonight, we will also talk about a little girl, an arson survivor for whom entire world joined hands to be her Santa. And nevertheless, the glimpses of Christmas festivities connecting the world. You are watching World Connect, your window to the world, a global picture of our times. I'm Sakal Bhatt, and now let's set the ball rolling with the focus of the show. Prime Minister Narendra Modi surprises all by making a sudden stopover in Lahore on way back home from Kabul, a huge step forward in the warming of ties between India and Pakistan. Taliban holding stronghold in Helmand province in Afghanistan sparks fears of Kunduz-like situation. Split verdict by Spanish voters leads to political uncertainty. Socialists nab Rajoy's aspirations to continue as Prime Minister. Sanchez says no to Rajoy means yes to change. And of course, the story of 8-year-old arson survivor who manages to smile through her wounds as her little Christmas wish comes true. In a first, Prime Minister Narendra Modi landed in Lahore on Friday on a sudden visit termed as surprise visit diplomacy by many. The Prime Minister, on his way back home from Kabul, arrived in the neighbouring country for a brief stopover. Nawaz Sharif's birthday provided the happy pretext for the Prime Minister Modi's visit. He is only the 8th Prime Minister of India in the last 7 decades to visit Pakistan and the first in 11 years. He was accorded a red carpet welcome as his special plane made a smooth touchdown at 4:20 local time. He then took a chopper to proceed to Sharif's Raiwind palatial residence in the outskirts of Lahore and held talks with him. The visit came more than 2 weeks after Modi and Sharif had an unscheduled meeting at climate change talks in Paris. There seems to be beginning of a new end to crisis for Nepal, at least for now. The protests staged by Madhesis at the border crossings with India have intensified. In fact, Madhesis are showing total reluctance to accept the Nepali government's plan for redrawings of internal boundaries. The standoff continues.
Ethnic Madhesis in Nepal have vowed to continue with protests at border crossings with India after rejecting a government plan which they say does not meet their call for a redrawing of international boundaries or offer adequate national representation. The landlocked Himalayan nation adopted its first post-monarchy constitution in September with a hope that this would usher in peace and stability after years of conflict. Some Madhesi groups launched a strike in the southern plains, blockading a key traffic route across the border with India. For the last 3 months, protesters have blocked trucks coming in from neighbouring India, leading to acute shortages of fuel and medicine. About 50 people have been killed in police shooting and arson attacks by protesters who are demanding that the entire Southern Plains region not be split into more than 2 provinces as the government plan envisages. The Nepalese government has said that it would task a panel to settle internal boundaries on the basis of political consensus within 3 months. The government has offered to amend the constitution to include the provision of proportionate inclusion of minority groups in government institutions and carve out electoral constituencies on the basis of population. People of hill origin known as Paharis have mostly ruled Nepal. The Madhesis complain there is no sign of this changing in several other regions too. As ethnic sentiment grows, self-defense groups are emerging in the name of different communities demanding a voice. Madhesi demands relate to citizenship, boundaries demarcation, creation of 2 separate provinces in the Tarai region. Madhesis want right of citizenship by naturalization should not be pulled out. Through Indian mediation in 2008, agreement was reached between Nepali Congress, CPI-UML and Maoists, under which the Madhesis' demand of an autonomous Madhesi region and equal civil and political rights had been conceded. At present, the Madhesis get 48.4% of 116 seats out of the 240 in the Nepalese parliament. For Nepal, India is an influential neighbour and traditional supplier of the bulk of essential goods. India has maintained that the latest offer on the constitution could create a basis for the resolution of the problem.
While Nepalese government suffers a big blow to the truce, the situation in battlefield Afghanistan continues to simmer. The latest reports from southern Afghanistan suggest that Sangin district in Helmand province is now almost entirely under Taliban's control after days of fierce fighting.
It's been hardly 3 months since the embattled Afghan government won back the city of Kunduz from the Taliban. Another major town reported to be on the verge of collapse. The militant group is said to have strengthened its hold on the southern town of Helmand as it almost captured the Sangin district. The town has been witnessing fierce fighting between Afghan forces and Taliban militants for several months. British and American troops have struggled for years to control it. Raising an alarm, Helmand Deputy Governor Mohammad Jan Rasul Yar had recently said that unless President Ashraf Ghani took urgent action, the province would be lost. The government, however, has rejected reports of its forces falling weak.
There is reinforcements is already there. There is a plan for a broader operation around that area. There is other areas which were under the pressure, but those attacks were reverted, and there were some very good success in some other district in Helmand province.
Over the past 6 months, Helmand has been the battlefield of insurgents and security forces. Afghan forces are trying hard to save the province. A center of opium production in the Taliban heartland, Sangin, a key district in Helmand bordering Pakistan, was once the center of operations for international forces in the country. Sangin's richness in opium means potential tax revenue for the Taliban from the drugs trade. The district links Lashkar Gah, the capital of Helmand province, to the northern districts. Regaining full control of Sangin would increase the Taliban's mobility in the north of the province and cut a key supply line for Afghan forces with Lashkar Gah. In case of a fall of Helmand, it would deliver a blow to government claims that Afghan security forces fighting without international troops are controlling insurgency. As the threat grew, US and British troops have been sent to Helmand. Amid rising violence and a deteriorating security situation, US Secretary of Defense Ash Carter made a quick visit to Afghanistan last week. Carter met troops at a U.S. base near the city of Jalalabad and assured that U.S. was committed to supporting Afghanistan. The fresh threat surfaced amid government's plans to reopen talks with the Taliban. The U.N. has raised its threat level for roughly half the country to high or extreme for the first time since the U.S. invasion in 2001. The volatility in Helmand has also sparked fears of a Kunduz-like situation arising again.
While Afghanistan continues its war against Taliban, international community has mounted massive efforts to reinforce peace deal in Syria. Qatar and Russia have agreed on a peace plan to encourage Syrian government and rebels enter into a dialogue. Qatar, however, has questioned the preparation of a list of opposition to take part in the proposed talks. The meeting of foreign ministers of Qatar and Russia in Moscow discussed which opposition groups could take part in the peace talks. With crucial backing from the US and Russia, the plan aims to install a ceasefire in Syria, possibly in the month of Jan, when talks in Geneva and Switzerland could also begin. And now on to political developments in Spain, where last week's parliamentary polls resulted in a split mandate. With Prime Minister Rajoy losing majority amid political negotiations, what really remains to be seen is which permutation combination fits in best to the current scenario in Spain.
Days after Spanish voters gave a deeply fragmented verdict in parliamentary polls, Prime Minister Mariano Rajoy's aspirations to continue suffered a major setback. The country's Socialist Party has refused to back any attempt by Rajoy to form a new government. His party, having no obvious coalition or partner, is now desperately looking for support.
Spain can't allow itself a period of political uncertainty that would ruin the progress that, with so much hard work, the Spanish people have achieved in these last years.
Rajoy's People's Party emerged as the largest party in last Sunday's vote, winning 123 seats but falling short of a majority in the 350-seat legislature. The socialists, led by Pedro Sanchez, secured second place by winning 90 seats. two new entrants have smartly been placed with the anti-austerity Podemos winning 69 seats and the centrist Ciudadanos gaining 40. Socialists became People's Party's first hope to ensure that they retained power, but Sanchez, who met Rajoy on forming the government, rejected a possibility of a government led by the incumbent.
Estamos en una jornada histórica.
The Socialist Party is not going to support the continuity of either Mariano Rajoy nor the People's Party in government.
Spain's politicians are already facing internal challenges, particularly the two embattled leaders of the establishment parties, Mr. Rajoy and Mr. Sanchez, who lost a major chunk of traditional voters to the two newer parties. Podemos and Citizens are entering parliament for the first time. Podemos leader Pablo Iglesias also came up with an idea of a government led by an independent figure with prestige rather than either Rajoy or Sanchez, while Ciudadanos or Citizens leader Albert Rivera suggested a three-way pact with the PP and Socialists, which would see Podemos marginalized.
We want to propose a pact for Spain to both the Socialist Party and the People's Party.
With political negotiations dropping no concrete signal, the continuing deadlock is also expected to elevate the role of King Philippe VI as a political mediator who will nominate a prime minister after the new parliament convenes on January 13th. In case no politician wins the approval of lawmakers as prime minister within 2 months of royal nomination, there will be new elections.
But the news from America's campaigning in the 2016 U.S. presidential election continues unabated. Democratic presidential candidate Hillary Clinton expanded her criticism of Donald Trump's comments on Muslims, telling supporters in Iowa that Trump's comments have consequences.
It has consequences. It has real consequences. You know, people around the world pay very close attention to our election. It is playing into the hands of the violent jihadists. There is nothing they want more than to be able to claim that the United States is against Islam and against Muslims.
In fact, Trump had demanded an apology from Clinton over similar comments that she made during Democratic debate. Trump also made off-color remarks to describe Hillary Clinton's loss to Barack Obama for the 2008 Democratic presidential nomination and then poked fun at her taking a bathroom break during a debate.
I may win, I may not win. Hillary, that's not a president.
Meanwhile, U.S. Senator Lindsey Graham has pulled out of the race for the 2016 Republican presidential nomination, leaving 13 candidates in the party's still crowded field. In news from Africa, Boko Haram continues to rattle the lives of innocent people in Nigeria. Boko Haram's six-year insurgency has kept about 1 million children out of school in Nigeria and has devastated northeastern Nigeria and has also spread to Cameroon, Chad and Niger. A UNICEF report is ringing alarm over the situation, calling for addressing the crisis immediately.
In a shocking revelation, an estimated 1 million children are deprived of school education as a result of violent attacks by Boko Haram in Nigeria and its neighboring countries. An alarming report by UNICEF said that the ongoing violence has led to the closure of more than 2,000 schools in Nigeria, Chad, Niger and Cameroon. Hundreds of others have been attacked, looted or burned. Children particularly under target by Boko Haram have been subject to sexual abuse, forced marriage, abductions and brutal killings and are used as weapons. Living under constant terror, many families are keeping their children away from schools and classes. Boko Haram, often translated as Western education is forbidden, advocates introducing a strict version of Sharia law across Nigeria. The group has recently pledged allegiance to Islamic State, changing its name to Islamic State's West Africa Province. Founded in 2002, Boko Haram initially focused on opposing Western-style education and launched military operations in 2009. Around 20,000 people have been killed and about 2.3 million displaced since the violent campaign started. One data says that more than 800,000 children have been forced to flee their homes because of the conflict. Hundreds have been abducted by Boko Haram. United Nations has said that the deteriorating situation, which has kept many children out of the classroom for more than a year, is putting them at risk of dropping out of school altogether. It's not only families who are afraid. Insecurity and the threat of attacks are also discouraging many teachers from returning to classes. In Nigeria alone, about 600 teachers have been killed since 2009. The crisis has threatened a whole generation of being deprived from education. Underscoring the urgent need to address the situation, experts believe that if nothing is done urgently to stop the destruction, the next outbreak of insurgency could well be worse than what has been witnessed.
And before we get a flavor of entertainment and festivities from across the globe, here are some more stories that are making international headlines. Well, from who has actually topped this year's overpaid actors list to infamous faux pas at this year's Miss Universe pageant, which hogged international headlines. This and much more up next.
You look very good for your age.
It's certainly not the list that any actor wants to top, but this year's most overpaid honor goes to Johnny Depp. The Pirates of the Caribbean star, whose box office magic has taken on a diminished status with films such as Mordecai and Transcendence, has overtaken Adam Sandler's position as the most overpaid actor in Hollywood. Ariadna Gutierrez, Colombia's Miss Universe contestant, who made headlines after being falsely named as the winner of the pageant, sounded on a positive note about the gaffe. Expressing gratitude towards her fans for showing their support, Ariadna said that everything happens for a reason and she was very happy for the role she played. Peter Landsman directed football head drama film Concussion hit US theaters on Christmas Day. The film stars Will Smith as Nigerian forensic pathologist Dr. Bennett Omalu, who uncovers the degenerative brain disease in former Pittsburgh football players that died sudden and tragic deaths.
These men are not machines. We must honor our warriors.
The film comes at a time when head trauma is a hot-button topic in the multi-million dollar NFL industry.
Tell the truth.
South Korean rapper Psy, best known for his hit song Gangnam Style, held the first concert on Thursday in Seoul after releasing his latest album early this month, Olympic Gymnastics Arena, where Psy's performance was staged was filled with more than 12,000 screaming fans
who turned out on Christmas Eve to watch the South Korean star. This Christmas Santa brought a big present for Beatles fans. The band's music has finally become available for free on streaming music services. Fans can now hit play on 9 services including Apple Music, Spotify, Tidal, Google Play and Amazon Prime. For years, the band had worried that its song catalog could be devalued by selling individual songs or falling victim to digital piracy.
In Human Touch, as always, we bring to you the stories of people who have touched perhaps millions of lives through being simply what they are, humane and fantastic. World Connect tonight tells you the story of 8-year-old arson survivor from New York, who despite having seen the worst of tragedy, manages to smile through her wounds.
A small wish to fill the cardholder with Christmas greetings. This was all Sophia Terry wanted.
How many cards do you think there's going to be?
20.
Just 20 cards would have done the trick for the 8-year-old. But what she received was way beyond what she had expected. She made the wish. The world granted it. Millions of cards and over 1,000 packages. A personal message straight from the US president and his family, and a week-long trip to Disneyland in Florida. The attention that Sophia has been getting is overwhelming. For all the little girl has done in the last 3 years is trips from in and out of hospitals. Sophia, a New York resident, lost her father and 3 younger siblings in an arson house fire. She was saved as her father had cradled her in his arms, but the scars from the incident will stay with her for life. She suffered 75% burns and has lost her right hand and left foot. Sophia's wish was posted on Facebook by her aunt, who since the accident has been her custodian. The post went viral soon, and the cards and gifts haven't stopped pouring in.
It's indescribable that there's so many people in the world that are coming together for her, that just to give her her wish. You have to share her with the world.
Since the girl's wish has gone viral, more than $400,000 has been donated through a crowdfunding website for her medical expenses. Sophia has also been presented a 3D printed prosthetic hand by students at the University of Albany. Though having seen the worst of tragedy at such a tender age, Sophia manages to smile through her wounds. Her wishes have been small. The first one was a cupcake for her first birthday spent in the hospital, and a hot dog when she left the intensive care unit. This time too, it was a small wish. The only difference was this world played Santa just to see an 8-year-old smile.
Well, it can be called the global festival because it actually connects and binds one and all across nations, across continents. We are talking about Christmas. Pope led the Mass in St. Peter's Basilica in Vatican, and hundreds of pilgrims attended the midnight Mass at the Church of Nativity at Bethlehem. A look at celebrations from across the world.
Thank you.
Well, besides all that is symbolic of Christmas festivities, the carols, the Santa, the goodies, the cake and much more, there is this one song that most of us have actually grown listening to, Silent Night, Holy Night. But have you ever wondered how it all began? I mean, the origin of this song. It actually dates back to many, many centuries ago. We'll tell you more.
A song many have hummed, others heard. A traditional carol, Silent Night is an integral part of Christmas celebrations. Sung across the world, the carol evokes the calm of the winter night. However, not many know of the humble origin of the song. The song, now sung in nearly 300 languages and dialects, including Japanese, Welsh and Farsi, was written in 1816 by Josef Mohr, a priest in Austria. Created at a time of war and hardship in Europe, Stalin Act was premier to a modest church congregation of ship laborers and their families in Salzburg region of Western Austria on Christmas Eve in 1818.
People were very poor, they lost their employment and they had to fight to survive. It describes also that the people should be good to one another, that they should forgive and that live together and that they should try to understand one another.
The lyrics were put to music by Mohr's friend Franz Xaver Gerber. An English version of the German original soon followed. By the end of the 19th century, it was being sung on all continents and recorded by singers.
Silent night.
From Bing Crosby to Miley Cyrus and even heavy metal groups.
Holy night. All is cold and all is bright and round the young virgin mother and child.
Well, this brings us to the end of this edition of World Connect. Do send us your feedbacks as you always do. You can write to us. Our email ID is worldconnect.ddnews@gmail.com. You can also follow us on our Facebook. But before we wrap up, we leave you with the images of some fantastic visuals captured of unbelievably innovative Christmas trees. And actually, these come from London to Damascus, from Moscow to Beirut. Merry Christmas to you all from the entire team of World Connect. Thank you so very much for tuning in. We shall see you next year with more interesting and inspiring stories from across the globe. Wishing all our viewers a very happy new year as well. Namaskar, take good care. Bye-bye.